of spiritual themes or inspiration coming from figures like a Superman, a Batman?
If we look at the early history of Marvel and DC, we have to note that, the way that they've treated creators is certainly not very stellar. It narrativizes human experience in ways that are not approved of by mainstream society.
If Jesus, from his storyline, can become the, one of the biggest faiths of the world, do you see our the notion of Batman becoming a figure, a religious figure, 100 years in the future? Or even Superman?
In a crazy way, yes.
Yes.
I think that anybody out there right now is a candidate for becoming a religious figure. Which is practically there.
So, is it still a bad idea? We can go into different shades of the human condition. We can go into different understanding of ourselves. We love these characters because we find a piece of ourselves in them.
People should be free to use the mythos that they choose to make the comics that they want. And they should not be straitjacketed by either commercial interests or religiosities.
You need to be very, very careful. You know, you cannot just, you know, just come in and say, you know, this is it, and just rehash certain things, and it cannot be modern.
Literature knows no barriers. Language knows no boundaries. The craft of a craftsman is unique. His ability to create a masterpiece is his own. He knows no rules. He makes them. He knows no horizon. He paints it. For he is the one who creates this ring, and his creation is immortal. Such an artist was born on September 4th, 1940. His contribution to the nation has been as immersive as his contribution to literature.
वो स्वयं एक लेखक ही नहीं उनके अंदर एक विचारधारा चलती उन्होंने जब भी जो भी काम किया बड़े लाइवली ढंग से किया बड़े जीवंत तरीके से किया और फिर खोल के उनका एक एक बंद जो है वो एक एक महाकाव्य कहता है
A soldier of the Indian Air Force, Group Captain Ranveer Singh, took on to writing at a very impressionable age of just 13. With his pseudonym, Kumar Vyogi, this laureate has been crowned as the father of Dogri sonnets and has been awarded by Sahitya Academy.
Kitni sonnet Hindustan mein, Kumar Vyogi mein, Dogri mein, ya Urdu mein, ya Hindi mein likhi hai, uska mukablan koi nahi kar sakta. Aur itni zyada likhi hai ki ye mujhe lagta hai
His masterpiece, Ghar, A Journey of Society and Relationships, ran into 238 verses.
Ik toda main rutti manga, sone ki ik tukkar, ik pal manga muskane ki, is tarti de, pairik manga rumi, garba ik chara, parchhante vich dunan tar, iya ji, ghar.
With a humble attempt to resuscitate Dogri language, Kumar Vyogi's contribution is priceless and timeless. Founded in his memory is the Kumar Vyogi Memorial Trust that endeavors to promote and preserve the history of Dogri language through literature, art, culture, education, and innovation. A platform to give back to the roots what you gained from them. Taking inspiration from Kumar Vyogi's belief that talent deserves to be nurtured and shared with the world, the Trust offers scholarships in the University of Jammu, Literary Award in association with Dogri Sanskha, and Talent and Innovation Award among other initiatives. Come, join the movement. Let's preserve our heritage. Let's protect our roots. Let's give back to the world. The gift of Dogri. Ladies and gentlemen, Welcome to Purva Yogi Memorial Trust.
If you want to know more about the panelists, you can always visit the official website of APJ Kolkata Literary Festival, aklf.in. Also, I do want you to know that book signings are going on at LN Park. So, if you want to get your book signed, you can always visit there. Thank you. We'll move on with the panel discussion.
Thank you very much. This panel discussion I was really excited about. It's a topic that's gaining a lot of mileage academically and in our standard discussions of anyone who's interested in popular culture or who's immersed himself into popular culture. Because as the Marvel Universe keeps growing and growing and growing, and as so much of the comic book genre is growing beyond the text, is growing beyond the books, it's enveloping a lot of themes, which to a great extent is redefining modern spirituality. And it's redefining what we consider mythology in this day and age. Which is why I was so honored to be to have Pinaki sir and Rimi ma'am over here. Is the rise of spiritual themes or inspiration coming from figures like a Superman, a Batman, to a great extent, even Star Wars, the concept of the Force and the Jedi Order and the Sith, is it a challenge or a viable alternative to orthodox spiritualities that have pretty much ruled the world for generations?
I think we have to be a little cautious about allowing corporations to define spirituality, because we all know what they're in the game for. If you look at the early history of Marvel and DC, we have to note that the way that they've treated creators is certainly not very stellar. I think that in one thing that happened with the early comics is that a lot of spiritual disciplines that were not mainstream made it into the genre, because the visual medium has always been a way of expressing non-mainstream mythos. If you look at the iconography of the tantras, you can see that. And we know that many of the early creators of both Marvel and DC were Jewish, and that they had instruction in traditional Jewish Kabbalah. So ideas from the Kabbalah seeped into early comics. But the thing about the Kabbalah is that it is, like many non-mainstream spiritual traditions, it narrativizes human experience in ways that are not approved of by mainstream society. And that's what makes it attractive. That's why people are attracted to these disciplines, because experiences that the mainstream world looks down upon or marginalizes or ignores can be expressed. And when you're not using words, it's a little harder to censor what's going on. You have to be a very sophisticated reader of the visual to actually see where the transgression is happening. I'm not just talking about nudity and obvious things like that. Which is why I would widen your category to include not just Marvel and DC, but also creators like Alan Moore, or Warren Ellis, or David Bay, or Marianne Satrapi, and say that these people are putting experience into the visual that otherwise cannot be expressed. Art speaker also. So these discourses need to happen, because sometimes the things that you cannot speak, you can only draw. When Spiegelman makes Mouse, he's trying to take an extremely traumatic experience, and he tells us in the book that he fails a couple of times. And he fails because he's thinking about it intellectually. He's trying to explain the details of what happened. He's trying to show the realistic nature of it, and that doesn't work. It's only when he makes it figurative that he can actually express what's going on, what the Holocaust was like, what it was like to survive, and then what you come out of that experience with, then what you do with that, how do you live with it, how do other people live with it. Very difficult. So comics can be misused, of course. I wouldn't say that every expression of spirituality in comics is wholesome or valid or healthy. I don't want to go into details of that comic. You can ask me if you want. But I think that comics power is that it communicates so easily. You don't need like very good linguistic skills to understand what's going on in a comic, which is why children like that. Which is why it's easy for people who are not literate in a language to access the literature of that language through comics first and then read the prose later. But that also means that things can get in under the radar, which we have to be careful about.
I always, if you think about our own mythology, everyone is aware about the story of the Ramayana. Ram was sent into exile, Sita abducted. So that the story is in our mindset, is in our conscience.
Yeah.
Story of Mahabharata is in our conscience.
Yeah.
But it's a static story.
Yeah.
It's
not static. But
in the sense that.
In the sense, it's a bit. Yeah.
In the sense, it's that is it.
Yeah.
There is no canon.
There is no canon.
There is no canon. Like Mam said.
But it's a bit received, you know.
Yeah.
That's
yeah. But
people
if I like
so.
Exactly. But if I go into, let's say, the Batman mythos, there is one version where Batman is in that alley, robber comes, shoots his parents, and that sets him on the path. There is another version where it's Bruce who gets shot, and Thomas Wayne, his father, becomes the Batman. Okay, and the mother is so traumatized, she becomes the Joker. So Bruce Wayne's mother, Martha Wayne, becomes Joker, and Thomas Wayne, who's a doctor by profession, becomes the Batman, and he has no qualms in killing criminals, unlike the Bruce Wayne version of Batman.
Oh, what bad parenting.
Yeah, there is another version. The robber comes, shoots both the parents. Bruce is not a kid in this one. He's 15 years old in this version. He's so traumatized, and then the Green Lantern ring comes to him. And then he takes the Green Lantern ring and he becomes like the Dark Knight / Lantern. So there are so many versions of that original story. Is this why the mythos is so expanded and wraps in so many people? Because it gives you a wide array of experiences as compared to, let's say, the Ramayana and the Mahabharata, which in their storyline are quite static.
No, actually, you know, Mahabharata is not that simple as well. And it's not that simple. Of course, there are many versions of Mahabharata as well. It's not as if there is only one version.
Yeah.
But I think in comics, you have cited Batman, which I think is a very good example. And look what Batman was. You know, the original character by Bob Kane has changed so much. You know, look at the intervention of Frank Miller, for example.
Yeah.
So, Alan Moore. Yeah, of course, there are so many. But say the Dark Knight, I'm just taking the Dark Knight because many know of them, but there are many others, you know, Grant Morrison. So many people worked on Batman, and it's always welcome. But that's the way, you know, any myths are. It can be transformative, it's always fluid, you know. Myths are not static, you know, any myth, you know, whatever it is. They cannot be static in any way.
Is there a resistance to redefine the Ramayana?
There is not. I mean, you know, yeah, the problem is, the way we receive Mahabharata and Ramayana presently here, you know, is somehow guided by certain optics. Okay, so, you know, certain ideology. So, say for example, the TV series somehow define the way we read Ramayana. So, what happens is when you read something, you know, there is always, it's a Ramayana, there are so many versions. The Kamban's Ramayana is not, you know, the same as, you know, the kind of Ramayana. There are so many versions of Ramayana. Mahabharata, you know, I'm not even daring to go into that because there is so many. Even in Bengali, for example, you know, the Mahabharata that is there, you know, it's a bit different from, say, what is there in another place. So the whole idea of myth is fluidity that's there. But what is comics? Of course, in comics, it's the same. It's the same. But I don't know what, I already think, you know, comics is the new mythology, it is the modern mythology. Probably the visual element is creating that kind of traction, that may be one of the reasons. Also, the kind of, and there is a bit of politics in it as well. You know, the way, you know, the studios and everything, you know, it's almost conspiring to make it a kind of a multiverse, okay. So that is making it a bit more, you know, a bit more visible with input. But if you actually try to make a Mahabharata, for example, in a very, you know, nuanced manner, it will not be simple. It is almost impossible to do. Maybe a book, even the translations of Mahabharata, somehow is now today, is a bit, you know, so it's a kind of monolithic, you know, but it's not like that. It's not the way the origin, the way the story transmits across different areas,
right,
even across Asia, for example. Say Ramayana in, say, Sumatra, or say in other places is a bit different, but you can know the kernel. So they have taken the kernel, the Batman stuff, but they have actually somehow, you know, created a kind of a visible idiom around it, and that is, you know, making it, that is making the people gain more traction. We can actually create similar traction, if you wish, with our texts as well. So there is a lot of, you know, what I call politics, and not politics in that sense, but yeah, hegemonic politics.
But like you were saying, there are different versions of the Ramayana.
Yeah.
There are different ways of looking at the Mahabharata. What I come from as a perspective is that popular culture and mass appeal.
Yes.
To a great extent, the different versions, now in February, was the end of this month, the movie The Red Sun is about the Tamil. This explores the concept, what if Superman, instead of landing in the farm of Martha and Jonathan Kent, landed in the Soviet Union? What would his life be like in Soviet Russia? And so that concept is there, and it's everyone is waiting for that movie.
That reimagining, you know, the mapping of things. That's part of me.
This kind of mass appeal, that different, and the platform with Netflix, like there's this movie on Netflix called Batman Ninja, which talks about a Batman in feudal Japan. Right? So my concept is, my point is, all of these different versions are getting these platforms and this mass appeal.
Yeah, that is what I'm trying to tell. So,
from our perspective, there is resistance to telling.
No, we have done it, but I don't know. I mean, in India, I don't know. You know, we somehow integrate, you know, religiosity so much with myth. No, that's a problem. You know, I think that's a huge problem. Sometimes, no, it's about, you know, deifying something. You know, you cannot have anything sacrosanct. You know, and when you keep something sacrosanct, this will happen. But you know, for example, Ramayana has been redone in certain comics, and I don't like that it has been redone. You know, so again, it is redone to cater to a kind of an exotic Western audience. Look what, say, the Shekhar Kapoor, Deepak Chopra, the Ramayanas, you know, the redo thing was done.
That thing got dropped also, right?
Yeah, it got dropped. I don't think it works that way. Because, yeah, if you just put in the story, you know, just, you know, dress up the characters in contemporary costumes, that's not the way it should be done. There should be a strong ideological basis in order to redo. See, if you don't do that, you will be completely missing the mark, and that is what is happening. So what you need is a more nuanced reading, a kind of reimagining in a completely different way. Because if you do it the way, you know, the way we are doing it, we will fall into the same trap. We will probably have a better VBX, we will have a bit better, you know, costumes and all that, but we are losing the soul. We are not getting the nuance right. We are not getting the heart of the matter right.
Would you agree with that?
Absolutely. And I also think that we so far avoided the, let's say, the difficult features of the American comic scene.
Yes.
Because we're more book-based, so individual creators get the chance to have their say without being sat on by a corporation. But if you look at the way that, say, an artist like Parismita Singh uses mythology.
Parismita Singh,
where she uses mythology from Meghalaya, I think.
Meghalaya.
So, people should be free to use the mythos that they choose to make the comics that they want, and they should not be straitjacketed by either commercial interests or religiosity, as Pinaki puts it. One of the problems with the Marvel Universe and also DC is that, well, they've stopped making comics. They're not creating any new comics. They're just taking the old stuff and squeezing it until every ounce of meaning has been taken out of it. And I really don't know where they're going with all this Red Sun stuff. Particularly in the present day, I think a story like that is deeply problematic. I would like to know who their founders are. The problem is that you can't, obviously you can't sell things to the masses unless there's some good in it. You've got to put some sugar in it. But along with the sugar, there's poison. So in fact, Virgin, which you mentioned, which was a total train wreck, came to India and tried to repeat the DC Marvel model in all Indian soil and failed miserably, thank God.
It can't happen
because it was only possible in the 30s when comics were still relatively undeveloped, people didn't know what it was. And therefore, the few who were creating could be corralled and essentially put to work like battery heads. That's what they did, and they're still profiting from it. And not enough people are mad about it. So, I think what we're seeing with Marvel DC now is the end stage of that process, where they have no creative content whatsoever. They're just taking all the categories and drawing lines and saying, okay, let's put Superman here. Let's put Superman in drag. Let's make a trans Hulk. Let's do this. Let's do that. Let's look for which market have we not touched yet. And
I'll just compare this with, say, you know, the Francophone scene, the Franco-Belgian scene. Look at Mobius, for example. Look at his universe, you know. It's fascinating. And if you just look at the way he has completely, you know, invented that, okay? That's another way.
Jared Leto is going to play Mobius.
Really?
Yeah, the vampire, right?
No, not the movie. The Mobius is, of course, the comics in the French comic artist.
The French comic artist.
So what happened is, you know, the world of Mobius, you know, and the French haven't, you know, done it into a film. It's almost undoable in a film. It's almost undoable. If you look at the entire universe, you know, it's very difficult to, you know, even, you know, no VBX can do justice to it because it's deeper than VBX. If you don't move beyond VBX, you know, that's the problem where, you know, Marvel is stuck. I like that old campy feeling of Batman. That's actually, you know, at least...
You prefer the Adam West over the...
you know, Evan Nolan is...
Nolan.
Evan Nolan was, you know, at least he had some idea, you know, he was maybe hijacked by the studios and all that, that's fine. But Evan Nolan had something. But what is happening now, you know, today, you know, the redoing of it, you know, going beyond Nolan, it doesn't make sense because it's just a monumenting process. So there are certain things that works in books, you know, there are certain, I'm not telling that it may not, you need a visionary and you need somebody who goes beyond, you know, beneath the skin of it. It cannot be just, so that's a problem, but,
I always, I want to get your takes on it. I agree with you that there is a redefining, you're telling different storylines of the same character at the end of the day. Is it unlikely to say that you can tap into different shades of the human condition through those different storylines? Perfect. Like, I'll give you an example. The Killing Joke is one of my favorite graphic novels of the Joker. Okay? Which just goes into his mind-bending kind of like psychosis. Todd Phillips's Joker, with the iconic Joaquin Phoenix, what he did in that film, it was also a different take on the Joker, where it was... He was shown as a mentally ill guy who had been abandoned by society, whose life was crumbling down. And they've used that same theme in the Batman universe where Alfred once says, life dealt you a bad hand and you chose to rise above it to become something. What is Batman if not an effort to master the chaos of our life? Okay? So that was that concept. And then you juxtapose it with the Joker, who became part of the chaos of his life. So, I've always felt, at least from a personal point of view, that once different storylines and aspects are mobilized through the same character, we can go into different shades of the human condition, we can go into different understandings of ourselves. We love these characters because we find a piece of ourselves in them, which is why they become spiritual and mythological to a great extent. So, is it still a bad idea to kind of like mobilize different storylines?
No, I'm not telling it's a bad idea. You can do that, but you have to move beyond the obvious, you know. Just one line. And you cannot just recycle the VBS stuff to, you know, make this happen. You know, of course, Phoenix, of course, playing Batman, Joker, was, of course, he's an accomplished actor, very, very accomplished, I must say. And, you know, in fact, he saved the story. What is there in the story? I mean, not much, but he was so overwhelming there. You know, he is the story. You know, he became the story. You know, you need that kind of accomplishment to make it. Now, I'm not sure what an Avenger universe, you know, a film, you know, whether they have that kind of graft, that kind of, they don't look for that. They look for, you know, the obvious things that will attract certain kind of audience.
I was getting into this with that man. First of all, Joaquin Phoenix's portrayal of Joker is canon. I mean, that feature of Joker has always been there from the beginning.
Yeah.
But the idea that Bruce Wayne is mastering the chaos of his life, I think that's a little problematic. Because if you look at what he does, I mean, he runs Wayne Corporation during the day and causes all the problems which are making victims. And then at night he goes and kicks the asses of people who are taking advantage of those problems to create more victims. I don't think that this is very unchaotic. I think this is actually adding to the chaos. And I think Alfred should have pointed this out because, I mean, he should have known. I think the biggest problem in the Batman universe is that Bruce Wayne has no idea what he's doing. And nobody is going to have the guts to tell him, except the Joker, and nobody says the Joker. So that's probably symptomatic of what is wrong with the whole system. And Marvel, of course, is never going to highlight that because they are part of the problem too. And if you didn't think they were part of the problem, you just look at Tony Stark, and he's clearly starting the problem.
But aren't our mythological figures always problematic?
Yeah, always. But this is a different kind of problem.
They don't become mythological because they're problematic. The problematics of mythological figures are there because society itself is still problematic.
Okay.
And they're just embodying.
Because I always think of, let's look at Rama. Okay. I think as I've grown up, my understanding of Ram has also changed. When you were younger, when you were watching the Ramayana saga, Ram was the hero. He's the apostle of virtue. Okay, you get a little older, little dodgy. This guy's a little dodgy. Then you become an adult, man, how could he treat his wife like that? Man? What kind of a guy treats his wife like that? So, as you grow older, the understanding changes, the character changes, but yet at the same time, you latch on to different aspects of that character as you yourself go through life. And that elevates certain characters to a kind of mythological figure or spiritual figure. And I think their problematic nature, look at all the Greek gods. They are super problematic at the end of the day.
Yes.
But they show that what humans can do with all that power. And how it corrupts them. And I think that's what adds to the mythos are like supercharged versions of ourselves. Of all our flaws.
Yes.
Right? So, while comic books can enter that space, can't they? Yeah.
They can. I mean, but the thing is that when you're talking about modern mythology, I mean, if you're still stuck there where, you know, here is a big problematic person who is like every other problematic person, then where's the modern in that? Because presumably we've learned something in the last 3,000 years, and in which case we should probably have some perspective on what exactly is wrong with this mythology or this mythological character. And otherwise, there's...
I think so.
As creators, as writers of stories, we have to engage with our team, we have to question it, we can't just take it as received by the universe, because then we're not creators, then we're just mouthpieces, we're just radio stations. Yes, of course, experience is going to teach you that the character is problematic, but the real question is, why did you fall for it in the first place? And why did society set you up to fall for this character so that you spent, say, 20 years of your life thinking he was a hero and probably making a lot of mistakes because of that until life kicked your ass and you figured out that he was not or that large parts of him were not. So everybody gets stuck in there and then has to climb out of that mud. But by the time they do it, often the problems which they were unknowingly part of have gotten worse. And we can see that in the world today. So I think the time for us to say, oh, but this is canon, I can't mess with it, is gone. Because essentially, then we are just saying, we're just raising our hand and saying we can't.
I wanted to get your thoughts, both of yours, on Star Wars. How many Star Wars fans here? Two.
Okay, I'm the last Star Wars fan.
I'm sure the new films don't do justice. I mean, at least I haven't been able to attach myself to them.
What you said about Ralph, I would probably say about all of the stars.
All of them,
Star
right?
Wars.
Yeah, absolutely. But I'll get similarly. Okay. When I started watching Star Wars, Star Wars for me was, you know, guys with laser swords, just like, you know, good guy back then. Okay. But then there was one of the most reviled Star Wars movies was, I don't know why, Revenge of the Sith. Okay. And with Hayden Christensen, everyone hated him as Anakin Skywalker. But there's this scene in that. So what happens is he's seeing his wife, he has visions of his wife's death. See, similarly, he had visions of his mother's death before she died. His wife is pregnant, he's having visions of her death. So first, the first person he goes to is his spiritual leader, Yoda. Okay, and he asks Yoda, what do I do? And Yoda tells him, and that line had a huge profound impact on me, which made me think that maybe there's more to the Force concept. When he said that, learn to let go of everything you fear losing. It's the only way you can achieve a sense of enlightenment and be one with the Force. Right? Beyond this, he doesn't do that, of course. Yeah. Which is why he turns to the dark side. He becomes Darth Vader. Right? So, to me, that concept was that it showed a man who is struggling with duty, love. It showed that inner turmoil. It showed the kind of very, I would say, austere path to spirituality, what Yoda was telling him. So, is Star Wars, I don't know in the current format, but can Star Wars offer a blueprint of parallel spirituality to something like Buddhism and all these other concepts?
It's certainly a gateway drug.
With?
It's certainly a gateway drug.
A gateway drug.
Okay. Yeah, because when Star Wars, when the first, well, before the movie came out, nobody in the West knew a damn thing about Buddhism. So it was, it had a lot of, it had impact. It made all that stuff cool. And of course, then people got, people educated themselves and the internet showed up and people could Google Buddhism and find out what the hell it was. But Lucas didn't keep pace with that. He was still stuck there and then he got trapped by the whole big corporation, I want to make money thing. And Industrial Light and Magic just lost the plot. He forgot why he had gotten into the philosophy in the first place. So, I guess the trajectory of Star Wars, the franchise, parallels the trajectory of Star Wars, the story, where all of these well-intentioned people try to save the universe and make a thorough and horrible mess of it.
Yeah, and the new films have lost the plot when it comes to the spiritual.
You know, that's what I'm trying to tell you. Know the way the new films are going, they have not the soul, the heart of it. So when it came out, I know it was a bit, you know, problematic. You know, we couldn't figure it out initially, but when we figured it out, you know, there was certain things attached to it which we treasure. But the new film is not necessarily rehashing the same thing. So it's again, you know, that's what I'm trying to tell you, know. Of course, comics are the modern mythology. That's always, you know, I acknowledge that, you know. But you need to be very, very careful. You know, you cannot just, you know, just come in and say, you know, this is it, and you just rehash certain things and it cannot be modern. You just cannot rehash certain things and say that this is what modern mythology is. It's a very loaded term, right? Modern. The word modern is very, very loaded. I can just give you one example. I have certain things to show. Yeah, so I don't know. I just wanted to show one thing. You know, I just wanted to. Yeah. So can I just. One thing first, of course. Yeah. So, you know, look at this, for example. You know, Isabel Greenberg. You know, I just want to focus on this kind of writers. Now, she was. She used to do illustrate books. Like the ancient Greeks, the ancient Egyptians and all these, right? So, she got the ideas of those small mythical universes contained with it. She actually came up with this huge work. It's like a 300-page work and it's called the Encyclopedia of Early Art. It's about a person who is in the North Pole and he finds love in the South Pole, but they cannot meet each other. So, what they do? They can narrate their stories within stories and they create myths out of already known myths. So the entire book, 300 page, is a kaleidoscope of old myths collapsing into new myths and new stories becoming old. So what I'm trying to tell you, if you can somehow, you know, rework the way, you know, myths are, you know, just rehash it. You know, we know Joker, of course, Phoenix will probably win an Oscar for it, and you know, of course, he has a huge part and deserves it. I mean, I have no problem in it. But Phoenix is the North Man, and you see what happens, because that is where the challenge is. Because the stories, what you see in the Batman stuff, is not as unique as it seems. We make too much of it, but it's not as unique as it seems. It just, I want to show one, two, you know, references. So they are retelling the whole thing, you know, the Great Flood, you know, this, but it's a different kind of a myth. It's the Great Flood, but it's again different. Just a bit more. I just want to show. So you see the universe through the bird man, remember? It's a very old Norse myth. So it's not a new, but the stories are new and old. You cannot make out what is old and what is new. So the old and the new somehow, you know, resonate with each other and echoes with each other and create something alchemic. I don't know what, but I'm very influenced by it. I just wanted to, I just want two more maybe, and then we can get back. So it's about storytelling. That's what I'm trying to tell, you know, the story. And it's very, very easy to say, you know, Batman has a story. But remember, The Dark Knight has a very, very, you know, simple plot, but the way they tell it, it's masterful, right? So that's what I'm trying to tell. Just maybe two, three more, and then we'll go back to the discussion. There is also another thing. Just go on. Yeah, 100 Nights of Hero. The same, you know, 100, you know, the stories again, the old myth of the Arabian Nights story and all that. But here, the characters who tell each other are basically, they love each other. Hero and Cherry, they are both women. And they want to, you know, their love, you know, they consecrate their love through stories. And again, you see, look at the beginning of it. Just next one. In the beginning was the world, next side, and it was weird. And it sets the pattern of what follows after. So what I'm trying to tell, I think, I'm not the person who, you know, who DC consults or anybody. I don't know, there are great people, you know, whom they consult, but they end up doing the same story. That is where I have a problem. Yeah, so that's a problem. That's where I always think you should hunt for these kind of stories, maybe look out for it, and then see what happens. Because they have the huge, what I call the machinery to mobilize people. This guy, Isabel, doesn't have it. Maybe some have it. So I want people to discover these new mythologies. Okay. Just a side like I wanted to show. This is actually by Jonathan Cape. So it's a mainstream publisher. Now today, Jonathan Cape is a proper mainstream publisher in Britain. In fact, she won the Cape Award and she won Eisner's and all that. The highest award for comics. But we don't know of it. Nobody knows of it. In fact, even in Britain, very few people know about it. So even if you do Batman, I'll just say, you know, Chip Kit, one of the greatest cover designers, came up with something called the Bat Manga. You know, that Batman, I haven't read anything close to it. Nobody, you know, in fact, once, you know, one of the corporate, Columbia, wanted to redo Bat Manga. But Chip Kit said, you know, whatever changes you are making, you are not getting it. I want to do it in a different way. So somehow, let the big be there. But also make room for the small to tell their smaller stories. You know, that's where I think you get the real mythology going. Unless you do that, you only have the big corporations meet, and the smaller fishes have, as if, you know, they have nothing, and they will just follow. It's like the Pied Piper, you know, they are going, and you know, all the rats are following them. You don't feel that you are creating the myth for everybody. That's the problem. That's what I'm trying to say. Yeah.
Like you were saying, the vehicle is very important.
Yes.
The vehicle of storytelling is what's keeping pretty much the mythos alive of a lot of these things. And to me, if I look at the example of, you compare Batman to Star Wars. Okay. These new Star Wars movies, they have really missed them.
Yes.
And which is why it's such a divisive kind of, the entire Star Wars universe has been divided over these movies. Yeah, and everyone's like, this is the curse of Disney, to something that was so original and so beautifully done by George Lucas. And this is what's happened. And he sold it. He made a lot of money. So, and on the other hand, you still have the Batman universe, and you have people who are still wholeheartedly behind the movies.
Yes,
the movies
yes.
aren't divisive as such.
No,
because to a great extent, Nolan breathed such life into the mythos. He kept the human struggle element alive. He, in my opinion, with Heath Ledger, redefined the face of evil in the modern era to those themes of terrorism and everything. So I always feel the vehicle is important. So, obviously, new mythologies are coming up, like you were showing over there. New ways of storytelling and new concepts of the human condition are coming up. But the vehicle is very important at the end of the day.
Yeah, the way you use it.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah.
Because I think in our social media era, if you don't create a good product, they will crucify you for not creating a good product.
The word product, you know, frightens me.
So,
the word product frightens me because...
Oh, the word product.
It's not the bad. I mean, it's
yeah.
not bad as such, but the very, you know, uttering... I think it should be passion.
Yeah.
If it is a product, fine. Let them define it. But, you know, the passion should be more... If you set out to create a product, you are more likely to fail. You put your passion to play, you end up with a product that doesn't matter. I mean, it may happen. It will happen. That's what I'm trying to tell. So if you wish to create a masterpiece, and this is my masterpiece, you are definitely not going to create anything. That's what I'm trying to
tell. Yeah, I totally agree with that. Which is why I'm saying that Lucas is such an exemplar, because
yes.
when he started out, he did actually have some integrity. I mean, he didn't just make Star Wars, he made American Graffiti, right?
Yes.
Yeah, which was actually quite good.
Very good.
So he got that far because he had talent and he had a story and he had some passion to tell it. But on the way, he got addicted to the rewards, and that's what ruined him. So all of his characters are like that as well. That's exactly what happens to all of them. So that's his mythos. So he keeps expressing it whether he intends to or not. And you see, the problem with how art is made and marketed in the world today is that there are essentially two categories of artists and two categories of market. You have been talking about Marvel, DC, Batman and all these. All of this belongs to the corporatized market.
Yeah.
And the rules there are completely different. But what Pinaki has been talking about and where we come from is the market of the small creator. And that is a completely different philosophy and a completely different way of working. And they're both perfectly valid. But the trouble is the first one keeps trying to eat the second. And it takes away all the oxygen, it takes away all the space, it takes away all... Everybody just wants to talk about the big stuff. But they also keep saying how bad the big stuff is.
Yeah.
So whenever they say that, I jump in and say, look, there's plenty of good stuff out there, just use your search engine and find it.
Yeah.
People don't want to do that because they get stuck in that universe, in the corporate universe. They don't step out. So our job, we're scholars and creators, our job is to tell people, hey, here is some cool stuff you might enjoy. Get out to do a little circle and have a look. And usually people say, wow.
Yeah.
But the thing is, the barrier they have to cross in order to get to that wow moment has been put there by the systems that have been essentially squeezing the market into their preferred shape.
Mm-hmm.
So, and they are parasitic on the small market because all of the people who made it big in the big market started out small.
Right.
And they had integrity when they were small, and then it got sucked out of them because they had to play by those rules. And that's a problem. It's a problem across the board. It's a problem in every sector. It's a problem with everything that people create.
Right.
It's a worldwide systemic problem that we have to do something about before it completely takes the world down.
Right.
Would
you say the anime universe is a little more...
It's different.
Diverse?
It was.
Okay.
Yeah, it's... Now, I think the problem with the anime market is that America has become a large sector of it. So now everything is becoming Americanized.
Yeah.
And all of the problems of the American market are being imported into Japan.
Right.
And because there has been early contact there, we have late contact, so which is probably why Virgin didn't make it here. It's possible for the Japanese market to morph into a sort of outlier of the American market, and I think that is very problematic. Because all of the stuff about Japanese anime and manga that was interesting and quirky and attractive is likely to become marvelized.
Likely to become marvelous.
Yeah.
Even with platforms like Netflix.
Or even worse, Disney.
Creating.
Yes.
Like in something like Akira, for example.
Akira.
You know, somehow it went into the hall. Now it's in the system.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't know what will come out of it. I mean,
no,
the old Akira was a joyful ride. I mean, it has problems. Of course, it's a bit.
You see, what happens is American marketeers come to you and they say, this stuff is really cool. We love it. We want it. But if you're going to do it for us, here is our 16-page contract. And here are the rules. You've got to follow the rules. You don't follow the rules, you can't come to America. So people say, okay, I mean, it's our content. We'll follow the rules. What the hell? But they don't realize that the rules are going to change their content. And by the time it happens, it's too late for the person.
I'll just add, even the American market is not so monolithic, you know? Even the indie scene, for example. That's very, very interesting. So that's a problem. So as a filmmaker, like a soldier, you know, he starts in the indie scene, of course, and then he becomes, you know, so big and Hollywoodish. And no problem in it. He brings certain sensibility to the of indie scene to Hollywood, which actually Hollywood acknowledges now. But then he loses a bit of his bearings there. So what I want is, of course, let the big stay there, no problem. Let people make millions of Batmans. Every one, every month, I have no problem. But let all the others also exist. So you cannot monopolize, you know, a myth. You know, that's not the way myths should work. But there is this tendency to monopolize, and monopolize so badly, that the smaller myth, and it's same in India. For example, the Khasi comics, very few people know it. Khasi comics date back to 1940s. We have got this. Who cares about it? Probably, you know, we go to the media and do a PhD. Right. That's it. But, you know, if the mainstream media somehow you highlight this, nothing simple, maybe one story here and there. And then suddenly, you know, some more people will be interested. Let's bring maybe two more people. I cannot bring in 100. I don't want to either. Right? Let me bring two more. And that's what I'm trying to tell Ayushman. And that's where I think how myth should work. And we are actually looking at, you know, for example, the Bengali comics. And it's very interesting, Ayushman. You may not know this, but the Bengali comics is going through this Kishore Bharati archive, 1960s. Very vibrant. Very, very vibrant. Very strong and very, very popular. Right? Somehow we have lost it. And today what we do is, somehow we have lost it. We have lost the age. And what we do is we ape from the West. But during that time, there were certain creators who didn't ape completely. They, of course, they had models, but they didn't do it completely. So if you want to do the Sita, you want to do the Ramayana, you cannot just do Ramayana 3392. I can do Ramayana 5000 as well.
Yeah, yeah.
So that's not the way it should be. You know, look at what Amruta is doing, for example. You know, she always tells that, you know, it's not as if, you know, I'm champion of Amruta here. But, you know, she always tells me that, you know, if you want to do Ramayana, for example, I don't think you can do the way you... I will do it my way. Now, personally, I can just show one small thing, you know, just... Anybody here? Yeah, so I'm just interjecting this question. I'll just show you, can I just do, you know, the Mahabharata? I'm not too happy with it, but still I must say, you know, we all know, of course, the narrator of Mahabharata. It means that, you know, Salty, who is a subaltern, was also the narrator of Mahabharata. And what if you look at Mahabharata from Salty's point of view? So an artist here, so can, no, not Amruta, yeah, just a bit later, Shankho, can you guess Shankho? Shankho, S-A-N-K-H-A, yeah. No, next, yeah, Shankho 1. Yeah. So this is Salty, for example. This is, the book is called Vyasa. Okay, it's published by Penguin. How many people have read this? Okay, so this is Shankho redoing. This is Salty. So everything comes from Salty's head. So you have the Mahabharata, but all of it, can you see the, can you go a bit early? Before?
Before that?
So this is Vyasa. This is a Penguin publication. As mainstream as it gets. Go get the book. It's Mahabharata, but only told from Southeast point of view. And when you told it from a subaltern's point of view, Mahabharata changes. Because the whole story becomes different. And look at the, this is not an amateurish artwork. You cannot even tell that. This was published last 2 years. For 2 years, nobody picks it up. Now, when I go to lecture something, I scream my head out and, you know, look at this. Take this. Can you just go on? I mean, yeah, look at the paintings as well. Shankho is a very accomplished painter. And can you see? And one of the teachers, of course, my teacher, I think Rimi is also a teacher, Shibajita, has written that. Look at the scale in which it is drawn. So it's not even drawn unconventionally. Unlike as Isabella Greenberg, it was drawn unconventionally. It was not drawn unconventionally. Look at the way he has represented the horrors of the war. So that is how you create new myth, na? You cannot just look at the way, you know, the whole energy in the paintings. This is Mahabharata again. So what I'm trying to tell is that, so that's it. So what I want to tell is that you tell the story, same story, but be aware of what you are doing. There should be an ideological basis from where you start.
Right. So it's like back in the day when it came to spirituality. Your Marvel and DC were your Christianity and your Islam, right? Okay, they were the big studios. And the little guy was in that area is persecuted to a great extent for not conforming, right? The other kind of philosophies.
Well, DC began as detective comics.
Yeah.
And they were small.
Very small.
Yeah, they were very small and they were very cheap. But they got big because people like their stuff.
Yeah.
And the trouble is, in America, if you get big, you turn into a corporation. If you turn into a corporation, you become toxic. So that's what happened to George Lucas as well.
Yeah.
That his company became successful and he decided, oh, okay, I'm going to become this media mogul. So that's the problem. It's the overarching philosophy that causes these people to lose it. And unless, like, people actively resist, it's going to happen to them.
Right.
So Marvel and DC are actually betraying their origins when they become these. Now, of course, you cannot negotiate with them because they own everything. And they will give you a contract where basically they own the insides of your head. Even like creator like Alan Moore, who didn't want to work with them but had to work with them because they owned the copyrights.
Yeah.
He wanted to do a Batman story, he had to do it with DC. And you can tell. You mentioned The Killing Joke. I had to actually teach it once.
Okay.
And when I read that, I keep feeling that Alan was holding himself back.
Really?
Yes.
Oh.
He could have done such a good Batman story, but he couldn't because he wouldn't have taken it. They messed up everything that he's done. And of course, he had his friend. He did Watchmen, which basically just rips the
skin off. Yeah, yeah. Watchmen. Yeah, yeah. And
he
HBO's new adaptation. Did you guys enjoy that?
I cannot watch any adaptations of Watchmen.
No, I did.
You cannot adapt Watchmen.
See,
but this is my thing.
I mean, I've read the Watchmen comics also, right?
Yeah.
And I saw what HBO did with the material.
The new one,
right? I enjoyed it, but my point always is that. Don't they require that medium? Like you're talking about vehicles.
You see, all of the remakes of Watchmen just completely lose the point, which is that it is satire.
Okay.
Watchmen is taking the piss. that is Alan Moore's revenge on DC.
Alright.
Yes. And you can tell because like people behave as though the characters of Watchmen are actual superheroes.
Yeah.
But they're not, they're parodies of superheroes. And the central story, which is about the comedian, who is kind of like a weird love child of Batman and Joker, and Rorschach is separate. He turns out to be the villain. Yeah, but the guy gets killed in the beginning.
Yeah, yeah, the first one.
Yeah, he's like Batman and Joker sort of squished together and the reason you can't adapt Watchmen is that. First of all, you cannot read the book in one sitting. You just go mad if you try to do that.
Yeah.
And I think that Watchmen really, really makes sense to people who've seen like what Alan Moore is satirizing and can see how subtly he's done it. Because if you don't know that, then you take it straight. And you think that, okay, he's created awesome superheroes. Look at Dr. Manhattan. What a wonderful character. But he is like a toxic superhero.
Yeah, yeah, he is.
Yeah,
he's literally killing
people
around.
Toxic.
Yeah.
He's literally toxic.
Yeah.
And of course, that's also there in the Superman canon. That you know, he's just too powerful to be with ordinary people. But that's seen as Superman's tragedy, whereas Dr. Manhattan basically couldn't care. It's when you place the two side by side that you see what's going on here. And I think that Alan, the moment you try to squeeze him through like a big franchise trailer, you lose all the guy.
Okay.
So you have something that's soulless.
Okay. I also wanted to ask this one point. We've all come to the conclusion, I mean, you guys are talking from the perspective of academic creators, that the system is toxic and everything, but the scale is what it achieves at the end of the day to tell a certain narrative, to push a certain story.
Yeah,
I mean, to a great extent, you know, from back in the day, like Muhammad and Jesus, their stories were also like stories which through the institutions became a massive kind of follower. Do you see the notion of Batman becoming a figure, a religious figure, 100 years in the future?
No way.
Not at all. Or even Superman.
Because we're in deep shit.
Okay, or even Superman. So,
Superman is already a religious figure.
So, because he's the new age Jesus, that's what many people say, Superman. Yeah. But this is my issue. This is my question, not an issue. Like, if Jesus, from his storyline, can become one of the biggest faiths of the world,
yeah.
What is the salient difference from the Batman story today and it not becoming a religion like 100 years from now? Not saying tomorrow.
I'm not saying it can't become a religion. I'm just saying if it does, we should be afraid.
We should be afraid. I mean, that's what any kind of religion, I think, in any religion, we should be afraid.
Oh, yeah.
Right? But do you see it happening? Do you think it can happen?
In a crazy way, yes.
Yes.
I think that anybody out there right now is a candidate for becoming a religious figure. I think it's practically there.
Yeah, I look at Buddha, for example. I mean, that's an interesting example, right? But if you have seen the new manga, I don't know, Jesus and Buddha together, living in one apartment, all the same stuff. If you see that stuff, you can see the way, you know, that has been, you know, now part of the lore. Even, you know, doing very well outside Japan as well. So then just put it, say a Tezuka, you know, Osamu Tezuka's Buddha, for example. It's not easy to do that. I mean, he has just taken the field, he has taken the history, he has taken the stuff, but it's not as if it's not spiritual. There are so many, he has just taken the narrative, but the way he has done it, it's not obviously spiritual, and nothing should be obviously spiritual. Even if it's obviously spiritual, I don't think you get the point of these.
But that's the greatness of Tezuka, right? That he can take all of these nuances and put them in understandable
manner. Yeah, so that's why I think, you know, for example, even a big studio, I'm saying a Studio Ghibli, for example, you know, the Miyazaki ones, the beautiful films that they do. I have Miyazaki.
Yeah, I would like to see those become a religion.
That is so beautiful. They are big, they are not small, they are super, super successful. If you look at the, you know, box, you know, if you take box of his collection, for example,
Miyazaki
is not a good collection.
He's the one exception. He's the guy who did not George Lucas himself.
So he has created a corporation, but somehow I think the narrative, the way he has spent time on the narrative, and I have this book called The Behind the Storyboards of Miyazaki's, you know, films. So it's like a two-volume tome, 500 page. The kind of detailing the story has got, not the dresses, you know. So if you look at a Batman creator book, it will be all about the bat suit and the how the how Anne Hathaway looks in the Batmobile. You know, that's very, very important. Does she look the part? The look, you know, there's a problem today in today's film world. The first look. Nobody cares about the film. The first look is the last thing that you see in the film, right? The trailer is the god. You know, that's a problem. So that is why, you know, everyone, you know, somebody, you know, I'll just give you one small kind of thing, you know, like Bombay Velvet, you know, remember that originally, if you look at the story, Gyan Prakash's book, right? It was a very nuanced story. So when Anurag Kashyap took it, right? So there are a lot of comic material in that, which was extremely transgressive but very difficult to do. So he started off with a very, very, you know, interesting concept, and then he got lost in all this first look thing. And then what he got is what you saw, which is horrible. So that's the problem. So Miyazaki never compromised with the narrative. If you do that, you are lost. However well you make it, I mean, no kind of pyrotechnics is going to save you. The story is the last and the ultimate pyrotechnic that you can have. That's the human pyrotechnic. Remember, that's what human minds are aware of. So it's not dependent on the scale. A small film can be as lacerating as a truth. And you need to realize that. And once you get that, you know the nuance of mythology and modern mythology. It's not something that you put in somebody's mind forcefully. Let people choose. Let everything be on the table. And let everybody survive. Then see what happens. I have no problem say somebody wins by a mile. But let me also get a foothold. So that I can enjoy my story my way. That's my private mythology. And once I negotiate with that, I think you have got the whole picture.
So, but like you said, forcefully imbibing an idea, that's been the basis of every religion in the world. Right? To a great extent. That's been the basis of every religion in the world. Once it becomes a state institution, that's when it, they grow and they perpetuate themselves. And
Batman can be a religion, but you, the initial...
Yeah,
I'm not sure what it will be a bad... You know, Rimi, of course, I know Rimi and she's my teacher as well. And I got everything about comics, you know, from Rimi, so maybe we are sounding maybe too similar sometimes. But Ayushman, I mean, don't get... So it's not a gang up. But what I'm trying to tell is that Batman may be a religion.
Yeah.
It may be a brilliant religion. I don't know. I cannot foresee the future. Who knows what it can be? What kind of... Rimi has his own religion, and so he's a cult in her own right. So and this is something I can tell here, and it's public, first time I'm acknowledging it. But what I'm trying to, she's an inspiration. I mean, and period. That's what I always feel. I mean, that's another debate, another discussion. But what I'm trying to tell is, it can be a religion, and it may be. I don't know, because the way things are going. The way institutions are pushing through, because as you say, religions mostly are institutionalized, right? Personal stuff.
You want to see Batman bugs on the road?
The way, the kind of bugs we are seeing in the road, you know? I don't mind if there is one Batman bug coming out, I have no problem.
Doesn't Dark Knight Returns have a Sons of Batman cult? Right? So,
yes.
So you already.
Okay, you want to get into Frank Miller now?
So just from your perspectives, something you've read recently, something that's there in the ether, not many people are aware of, that is a really powerful spiritual piece of work in the comic book world, if you can just elaborate.
Okay. I always go blank when people ask me this question.
Can you think of it and I can show one thing? Yeah. So can you just, let me show you two things and then of course DVD will add. And I... No. I think Rimi is very, very well read. Just can go to Amruta, for example. Yeah, a bit of up. Of course, this is not Amruta's best work. I always think in a Kari. There was a work called Kari, which is very, very good, and which was very raw and good. But you know, what I'm trying to tell is, of course, now she got hitched with Devdutt Patnaik. So, again, a big figure. Again, the problems are cropping in. But still, this is Aranyaka. This is about... a woman called Katyayani. Because, you know, Jagavalka, the woman of Jagavalka, you have Gargi, Moitri, the intelligent ones. And Katyayani, the homely one. You know, she's called Katyayani the large. But she is, for Amruta, the Aranyaka. You know, she is nature. And so that story is Katyayani's story. Jagavalka is not even mentioned. He's always called Y. So the complete erasure of the male self, yeah. So, and then you have this, you know, story being told in a very personal, intimate style. Okay, there are a lot of spirituality in it. I think a bit of pop spirituality thrown in for good measure. I don't make too much of it, but it's a very interesting start. Okay, but So can you see a bit more? Yeah. So. And can I just go to Royal Existential? Yeah. But I want you to go. These are, you have to buy this, right? I want to show something that's free. That's on the net. And it's called Royal Existentials. This is Aarti Parthasarathi. What she's doing is she's taking the old mythical miniature paintings and she's just rewriting the stories of present day to day. So you have the Me Too, the movie is like the memes, right? So what you are getting is, you are actually juggling or you are actually creating a fine I don't know, playing with comics, memes, social media, visuality. This is inedible India. You take the Raja Ravi Varma paintings and put it in this form. This is all free. And look at this. You know the reason I love Delhi is that because Delhi always will be. So, but remember, this actually was taken. This is not a new inspiration. This is David Malki. He's a huge guy in webcomic, and he was no. And you can just yeah. It just you cannot give it in the autopilot. And, I'm sorry. So, that's it. So, David Malki was the first one to use the old stuff sorry for this. So, they took the template. So, it's something that you can do. And that's what I always tell my students, my you don't have to draw. You can do stick figures. And create your own myths. Why don't you don't have to be William Blake? Nobody is William Blake. He's one and only. He's a unique figure. You don't have to be that. But you can have your own myths, your own personal stories. And if you start off there, who knows? Batman started off a personal myth. Yeah, this is fine. Done. So who knows? So the first part, the first moment should be very personal and deeply personal. If it becomes institutionalized, that is not part of me. Shonko has arrived. I just want to introduce Shonko. Shonko was the man who, drew Mahabharata. The Mahabharata. So, can you just... he is the man who drew this. I showed this. And he has his unique take on Mahabharata. So it is... Yeah, you come. Because it is his unique take. And that is what I'm trying to tell. It starts with a very personal story. Let it start from within. Lucas started from within one day. Everybody started. Bob Kane, for example. All started from within. Let that be your spot and let whatever the world do with it. Let it be a religion. Let it be institutionalized. But first tell it from your end. And then you are not in control. I don't know. Let whatever happen.
I was talking about Mahabharata. How you did Mahabharata. How do you approach Mahabharata?
Oh, yeah. Actually, I used to work on Greek mythology, like employee there's a company in Delhi who is completely dedicated to comics. They used to do a lot of different kind of comics, and I used to do Greek mythology, like Jason and Argonauts, or Eros and Psyche, this kind of mythology that I did. But it's very difficult to work under an umbrella because there are certain aspects that you need to follow when you are an employee. So I was the employee. They used to give me a certain amount of remuneration for a book. So it was a bit difficult. That time only I got interested in mythical stories, and I find some striking similarities in the myths of Indo-European language. So then I, of course, we love Mahabharata, and everyone has to say something about Mahabharata. It is so, the story is so much intriguing. And then I started working on, and I wanted to create a different visual aesthetics. But I don't know whether I have succeeded in that or not. But at least I tried to do so. I wanted something other than Raja Ravi Varma, which is somewhere rooted in Western paintings of 18th century, 17th century, a bit of Baroque painting. Somewhere you can connect them with the painting of Agre or William Burugay, this kind of people. And I really don't, I somewhere wanted to read that text as a text that was written after the Iron Age settlement by the Indo-European language speaking people. Simple. So it's more about exploring the linguistic aspects of this text. Hello?
I can be heard.
It's more about exploring the... It's alright. Hello? It's more about exploring the linguistic aspects of the text. So because you know many words they can if you want to explore the words, it can tell you different kind of the tale of society. It can tell many things about the social structure, the caste system, the story. It can be the same story, but you can tell in a different manner. So I actually wanted to do that, and I was looking for a writer, and then I meet Shivaji Bondopadhyay, the writer. But initially we had no plan to work together, like because Pinaki probably knows him, or you also know him. He's a very difficult guy to handle with. He's almost like an eccentric sage, and I when I met him, and after 1 or 2 months, I was pretty confident that anything I do, I will not work with this guy, because this guy is beyond any kind of constructive argument or criticism. So it's almost impossible to go for a collaborative project. But then gradually something happened, then we started thinking together. We did couple of short stories, kind of small comics, like 12 pages, 30 pages on sexuality after the 377 laws and everything happened in our country. Then about a small work on totem and taboo, Freud's totem and taboo, and a small work on the letter exchange between Einstein and Freud, where Einstein asked Freud, like in 1934, there was a mission by League of Nations. That time headquarters was in Germany. They wanted a kind of intellectual interaction between then intellectuals. So Einstein wrote a letter to Freud, the first letter, and he asked Freud, like, why war? Why, like, the war or this kind of instinct for violence, is it normal for Homo sapiens? This kind of letters. And Freud, you know, he explained with his words and all. And it was a kind of letter exchange. We made a small work on that. Shivaji wrote that text. Then only we thought maybe we can go for a collaborative job. And it was a learning process for me as well as Shivaji Bondopadhyay, because it was mammoth task. It's a huge thing. And we tried to, of course, we're told that we are working on the second volume. The first volume.
There are 5 volumes, so they have only published 1.
Yeah. The second volume is on dice game, Panchali. So we are basically trying to take a bit of like feminist take on about the that moment of dice game. It's a bit complex because there Shibajita discussed about the the game of dice and its mathematical inspiration, because Shivajita is very much connected with mathematics. Initially she was in Delhi IIT to study mathematics. Later on he left Delhi IIT and he joined comparative literature. So he gave a very good description of how mathematics can influence a dice game and how
which is of no use to you.
No, it's very, very interesting. I can show you the panels. Like,
it would be an interesting chapter in that Mahabharata story also.
The backstory.
The backstory.
And it's kind of
like counting cards, you know, while you
like. And it's like I have taken it as a kind of a documentation, because comics, we can do anything in comics.
Yeah.
Like we can show few images at a time of different timeline. It's possible. Or suppose we are talking, 4 people are sitting here, we are talking, he is thinking something else, he is probably not into this conversation at all, and she is probably thinking, who is this guy, suddenly came and joined us. So you can actually show that in comics without disturbing anything. It's possible. So I actually tried to do something with that, that mathematical part and all, because he gave us, of course I don't want to disclose that, it's very interesting.
Quiet. So so I pose that question to you also. Do you think the mainstream comics today, all your Marvel, DC, Batman, and all these Star Wars, all these popular culture elements, 100 years down the line, can they become a religion like we understand religion today?
No, I think the people who, because I'm engaged to an institution, St. Xavier's College, I can see my students. So they are crazy about mainstream comics. Like, if I say this here, that mainstream, of course I say that in my classrooms, that when, you know, you have to read the comics, you should think beyond Batman, Superman, Batul, Hatabula, and the many things are there, definitely. But there can be more things, and the options, the lines are endless, the paths are endless. Like when you are, of course, in Batman also, or in Superman, there can be a lot of different kind of storytelling.
That is what you were stating.
Yeah, that is also possible. Like you can see when Frank Miller took on Batman, and he
was a religion.
You mean Batman. Organized religion?
Yes.
Frank Miller also had sons of Batman. It was a cult.
So can Batman? Of course, it's a cult, but can it be a religion? With
all religions are
temples of Batman.
Temples of Batman. So you have Jesus over there. Can you have like?
No, it's like if I see the power of mainstream comics.
Yeah.
Then I can of course say that it's like religion.
There you go.
And because organized religion, if you see the institutionalized religion, the way you see that, and the way they make it, they sell it as a product. Okay, so it is of course you can, if you want to read mainstream comics as religion, of course you can read that. And in that point of view, at some point, of course, me and a lot of my friends, we are doing exactly the other side of the river. We are trying to make a bridge, or simultaneously we are trying to fire the cannonballs.
So it's a faith war over there. So Mama, you were going to share that spiritually powerful piece that you've read recently.
Okay. To answer your question. There's a web comic that I follow called kill6billions.com, which is brilliant. It's absolutely brilliant. Yes. Will you also call it? Yes. Fantastic. That should become a religion.
What is it?
Kill6billiondemons.com.
Elaborate on it.
What is it? Okay, it's the story of this young woman called Allison. She's a barista in Los Angeles who falls into the world of the spirit. And she's nothing there. She's like less than a worm. And she's given the key to the universe without her consent. And everybody wants to rip it out of her head. And she has to figure out how to survive, how to rescue her friends, and how to make sense of what's going on around her. And it is utterly brilliant. It is drawn fabulously. It's by a guy called Abaddon. That's his like web name.
Yeah.
His real name is Tom Parkinson Morgan. And he's just incredible. And he has clearly studied the mythologies of a dozen religions. But you will not, they're never shoved in your face. They are there, and he's completely made something new out of them. So yeah, if you want to look at what spirituality looks like in a comic, look at kill6billiondemons.com.
So we've discussed like multiple aspects of the popular culture world and its connect to spirituality. I have one ally over here who's like 100 years down the line, my kids will be worshipping the Batman and these will be the figureheads of the cult movement that will go against that.
I'm sorry, a religion that has only Harley Quinn in it is not a religion.
Well, I want to throw out to the panel if they have any questions.
Yeah, good evening. My question is to Pinaki. Pinaki, I am a proud kid of Amar Chitra Katha.
Yeah.
Because I grown up in 80s.
Yeah.
And I am sure before my generation, who were growing up in 60s, 70s, they also...
They all,
See, when we gone through Amar Chitra Katha, and one after another, unknown mythological and epic stories were unfolded to us, it never played in our mind that somebody is having a hidden agenda behind that. Very unfortunately, very recently, we are finding there is a negative propaganda against our Chitrakatha, and a group of people are telling there was a nexus with some organization and Anantapai to create a Hindu propaganda among the kids and youngsters of those age. I just want to clarify one thing. Number one, how correct is the statement? Is it a totally politically motivated statement? Number one. Number two, if it is correct, how far comics can be successful in creating a political propaganda through children by telling heritage of its country?
Shomendra, you are actually now telling that comics can create a political party as well. If it can create a...
My question is very innocent.
No, but I think it's a good question.
Yes.
But Amar Chitrakatha, of course, is deeply, deeply problematic. And we all know that. There are numerous theses being written about it. It's not as if, you know, of course, when we did it, you know, I personally also, you know, read a lot of Amar Chitrakatha. It didn't cross my mind then, and I must be honest with you. But when I look at it, and when I see my child, you know, my son, when he actually can point it out, you know, he doesn't read it as innocently as I did during that time. Now, Amar Chitrakatha also is very problematic, not only because of its association with religiosity, but, you know, look at the patriarchal, you know. So, you have one Rani of Jhansi, but, you know, maybe a titular figure, but look at the patriarchal kind of mindset that Amar Chitrakatha, look at the scheme, look at the way, you know, things have been erased to fit in certain, have you seen Ambedkar's, you know, the comic, Ambedkar's comic, for example. So, yeah, Amar Chitrakatha. No, it's there. So, if you see the comic, Amar Chitrakatha, the way it is written, you know, some of the controversial within court, you know, problems. So, he's running with, say, Gandhi, right? There was a difference of opinion. That is erased. That's completely erased. I have it. I have the old...
Considering the target audience, that is somewhat...
No, but you could have put it. You know, if it is even if it is meant for children, you are actually talking about, say, Malat Satraga. Fine. That's fine. But when you have differences with another, you know, the problem is Amar Chitrakatha put all these people as icons. Too much of an iconic. You know, so they cannot do anything else. You know, they cannot be free, feeble, frail. The religious angle is complicated, and I must tell you, actually it started off as translations. You know, the Amar Chitrakatha used to do Western myths. The first five volumes were like that. But they soon discovered that this is not going to have an audience. Right? So they changed the track, and the first Amar Chitrakatha, which is Indian, is Krishna. And what can it, I mean, if you do, because Krishna, of course, is a very interesting god. I mean, if you look at Krishna as a god, very, very interesting, and I have no problem. But what aspect of Krishna they took? They somehow created a narrative, which I don't know whether it's tied up to an ideology, but it's definitely problematic. I think Rimi has a lot to tell on this. It's really problematic the way they erased certain things, not only in kind of mythology, but also in the lives of freedom fighters, the freedom struggle. Do you have any, say, any comic, Amar Chitrakatha comics on the tribal freedom movement?
No.
Probably you don't have it. You cannot have it because it's very difficult. So sometimes, you know, even the new Amar Chitrakatha started, you have the first issue is Kalpana Chawla's issue, right? Kalpana Chawla's issue came up. But after that, they recycled the old ones because they thought that that's not doing that well. So it's so market driven and it's very northern India audience base. So there are a lot of studies being done in real time and mostly unbiased study where they actually measured their responses and they then began to do series like that. So say Prithviraj Chauhan does well in certain sectors, they will bring in, you know, stories like that. Or say, for example, if say Krishna does well, or say, you know, for example, and then the southern market opened later, right? Then again, they began to recycle certain southern myths at the cost of others. So, for example, take somebody like Kamban, say the way he wrote Mahabharata, Ramayana, he will not be there in Amar Chitrakatha. So it's not as if they did it, I don't know, they have definitely commerce in mind. 100%, and
they popularized
the comics as a medium, but they also created a problem in India.
That exactly is their contribution. My
take is that they have contributed in building a readership, you know, in acquainting people with the visual kind of narratives. That's there. You cannot take it away from them. It's huge. It's so huge that you cannot take it away from them. But they also made comics the sole preserve of small children in India. As if, you know, the adults cannot read comics. And whenever I used to do comics, my mother and father used to tell, you cannot do research on comics because it's such a kid's medium. So that the problem with Amar Chitra Katha, and also in Hada Buddha, Bantul, and I have huge respect for Narayan Devnath, but he never allowed comics for grown up. You need to grow up.
There are comics
about everything today. Even a medical prescription can be a comics. One guy, Nick Susanis, wrote an entire PhD thesis in comics. We never allowed it. And it's not a small thesis. It's from Chicago University, it's on chemistry. You can do it. What is the comics on environmental issues? Well, the comics to, you know, build up support. Even a political manifesto can be a comics. Advertisement can be comics. So let the medium grow. These things never allowed the medium to get beyond the children market. So comics means shoved in the children's category. That's it. Everybody tells, comics is for children, not for the grown-ups. The worst kind of misconception that you can have, at least today. I mean, do you think 1 to 10?
Yeah, I think you should.
I don't know if I should say anything about Amar Chitra Katha because, I mean, this is not a suitable venue for me to talk about it. But yes, I agree with everything that Pinaki said. And I also think that, well, yeah, they may have created a readership, but I don't think that, well, there may have been some overlap between, say, the readership for Origin Chen and the readership for Amar Chitra Katha, but I think it must have been very small. As for their problematic ideology, it's interesting that I have met very few women who said what you said. I think that, well, I began reading Amar Chitra Katha when I was older because I didn't grow up in this country, and I was frankly appalled. because I went from reading Wonder Woman and the Hulk to reading, and I was like, this is what you guys read. And the contrast is glaring if you come from, like, a tradition where you can read Wonder Woman and then you read Lakshmibai and you're like, what just happened? Even if you look at other texts on Lakshmibai, you can see that they have dumbed it down and cleaned it up. And it was extreme. And I don't think the argument that this is for children holds because children grow up. And, like, you can't have problematic ideologies in a children's comic and say, oh, but it's okay, it's for children. That doesn't excuse it. That actually makes it worse. And I think the generation that grew up reading Amar Chitra Katha is now in charge. And that explains a lot, if you ask me.
Any other questions? Anyone? Yeah. Please.
I love the talk. There's a question to all of you. Wouldn't you think that other than mainstream comics, wouldn't indie comic subcultures also have their own tropes which they rehash? Like, if you look at the newly successful independent comics coming, like, there's also the rehash trope of a protagonist who is interpreting the world from their perspective and relating events that have happened to them. It's viewable in... I mean, to provide examples, if you look at Spiegelman or Sartrapi or Amruta Patil.
Look, everything in the world is rehashed.
Yeah.
Nothing is original.
I'm not calling it a negative.
I know that.
I'm just saying that, wouldn't you argue that tropes develop without the outside interference of corporations? I mean, other examples include the rehashed storylines of Shonen and Seinen manga. I mean, tropes have a way of rehashing themselves based on their readership, and would it essentially be due to somebody manipulating it from top? Wouldn't DC and Marvel and such tropes rehash themselves because of their readership and not because of the corporation controlling them?
I don't know. I mean, the manga thing I know. I mean, manga thing is not too different from, you know, the DC thing. Although it's a bit different in cultural context. But, you know, but what I'm trying to tell is, you know, Spiegelman, Satrapi, and you are right, I mean, mostly they are autobiographical, right? A lot of comics is out there, but it's not the entire gamut. If you look at the problem is, we know about comics so little here in India. You know, so look at somebody like a Chris Ware, right? Look at somebody like a Dan Klaus. Look at somebody like, I just reel off names, and it can be so much, you know, like Mark Antoine Matthew. Somebody like David B, for example, they are personal, but look at Matthew, he's actually doing architectural comics. Look at somebody like a David Maducheni. So he can tell Batman Year One, and he can then go and do Asterios Poly, which is actually on a failed architect. So it's not that easy. So you think the tropes are rehashed, right? There is always that, you know, it happens. You know, it doesn't. I'm not telling that it doesn't happen,
yeah.
And I'm not against it. But the problem is, essentially everything can be rehashed. But at least when it is rehashed, you cannot just dress it up and rehash it. You need to add another layer to it in order to rehash it. I mean, in that sense, a lot of films are rehashed. Right?
That's what you say is missing. That layer
Layer sometimes is missing. It's not as if it's not always missing, but layer sometimes is missing. So let me give you a specific example, and this is very, very interesting. I've talked about Miyazaki, I've talked about the Ghibli studio. So when Studio Ghibli wanted to do a kind of a Western story, a collaboration with a Western animator, they didn't pick up a big animator. They become a very small Dutch animator. Remember the Red Turtle? They did a beautiful, beautiful film. They became a very small kind of, and he was scared because, you know, nobody, Studio Ghibli is so big and he works in his own home. And Ghibli is as huge as a Disney or a Pixar, right? In that sense. And this man only works in his own computer. But Disney will never pick up that kind of a guy. He may pick up his story and rehash it his own way. So what Ghibli did was, given all the freedom, he became the head of the project. And so then the Red Turtle came out, and it took Khan by absolute surprise. And it just like ranked up everybody. Anything that animation film has never seen. People were absolutely flabbergasted, because this man is in control. You know, he's allowed. So you have the big thing of the studio, which he never had. But the narrative is his. So it, rehash is okay, but add something.
That's what I
yeah, it's a different philosophy completely.
Yeah. Anyone? Yeah.
I'm sorry, I don't know whether I can answer it, but oh yeah.
Well, my question is, what kind of an impact would a comic like Calvin and Hobbes that actually does emulate English and French theological pioneers? Would it have an everlasting impact on children who read it very frequently?
I think it still has an impact on adults, at least. I think like existentialism, nihilism, all plays out through Calvin and Hobbes, in my opinion. And I think it's a beautiful way, just from the basic problems of a child, the basic kind of eccentricities of a child, you've been able to mobilize so much thought and so much kind of like real world. You see, the different shades of the human condition are like mobilized through that. And it's a beautiful piece of work. And to me, I think to me, it's not a child's work. It's not a work for children. It's not Peppa Pig, I think, at the end.
It's not meant for children, for that matter, but children do read Calvin and Hobbes.
Yeah, they do read it. But it resonates with us as adults a lot.
Certainly
at the same
does.
Time.
So
I just want to add, because I had a chance to meet the artist. In 2015 Angoulême, I was there in Angoulême Festival in France. So, and he got a lifetime achievement award. So I had a chance to, like, as an artist, a small minuscule, like small artist, tiny artist. I met him, and I heard that he was retiring. He declared that he don't do comics anymore. So I asked, like, why? Like, our childhood is, you know, clouded with your artworks and your witty, like, moments. So he said, no, I think I'm going to repeat myself.
That's a
The basis of my question was, what kind of a transition would we experience when we undergo that change from a child to an adult? Because child psychology is quite different from that of adult psychology. So our interpretations of their theology, nihilism as you said, and maybe some concept of predestiny that John Calvin had. So how would we interpret it as a child and as an adult separately?
Okay. Now, your question answered the previous question. I think they're both, in a sense, problematic because they masquerade as critical questions, but they're actually coming from the market. Because it's the market that wants to compartmentalize readerships and, you know, make texts for a section. Because it's profitable. You make books for children, and you sell to children, pivoting the marketing things you can do to sell those books to children. But ultimately, this strategy is self-defeating. Because a book that concentrates on a niche market is like a specializing species in the environment, painting itself into a corner and sort of decreasing its appeal as a general text. The most successful texts, like Calvin and Hobbes, like Harry Potter, cross market boundaries. They are literal crossovers. And that is a measure of how good they are, because they're appealing to something universal across so-called market niches. So the problem with how products are made and sold is that the philosophy behind them is restrictive and ultimately anti-art. And it seeps into criticism because criticism follows the market. Like, criticism will look at what the market is doing and then theorize it. It will not break the mold of what it sees in the market. At least some form of criticism. So then people very earnestly ask you these questions, and then you have to say, look, if I'm going to answer this question, I have to deconstruct capitalism for you. That's going to take me 3 hours. So I think what you're really asking me is, how do creators like Bill Watterson make art that is not reducible to categories, right? That's what you're asking. And I think the reason, the way that they do it is that they look inside themselves and they find the core of childhood within them, and they speak that. There is a lack of introspection among many commercial artists and commercial publishers and studios, where they don't see the market as people. They see the market as wallets.
Yeah.
And they're like, how do I get into that goddamn wallet? You have to go through a person to do that? That's just a means to an end. And that is completely destructive of what art is about, because art is all about people. So we have to also be a little suspicious when criticism sells us these ideas that, you know, a trope has to be original, because what is a trope actually? What does that word mean? A trope is just a narrative device. It's a tool. And tools are eternal. We still use screwdrivers that were invented in prehistoric times. We still use saws and knives, and because those tools are the basis of how we interact with the world. So of course we're going to rehash them. What else can we do? They're the building blocks of art. But a brick is a brick. But what you do with that brick, that's your creativity.
Just to add another point to that, like, you look at any Calvin and Hobbes quote, okay? Like, in all those comics, he's going on this fantastical kind of journey with his pet tiger. And, you know, the scenery keeps changing, okay? And I think the difference between how a child sees it or an adult sees it is the emotional mileage. A child has very little emotional mileage as compared to an adult. So, like a quote where, you know, Calvin tells Hobbes, day by day, nothing seems to change, but pretty soon, everything's different. He's talking, a child will see that quote, oh, like, you know, the scenery is changing from one point to the next. But as an adult, if I read it, like, wow, that's some profound stuff right there. So, really? You think so? At least I never did when I read it when I was a child. Okay. But I was like, oh, that's
childhood
so cute.
Childhood changes too.
Childhood changes too, yeah. So I'm just, that was my perspective on that. Yeah.
So mine brings about a drastic change in our perspective from child to adult. Thank you.
Anyone else? Cool. So I think it's almost, it's 5 minutes to four. We're almost. We met our 2 hour. So thank you so much, guys, for joining us, and thank you guys for your delightful insights into the comic book world. And here's to the Batman religion 100 years from now.
Why 100 years?
Okay, tomorrow.
Yeah, as we see, the session was of really great interest. I could see a number of questions coming up from the audience. Yeah, so evidently comics are a mass favorite, is it?
Yeah.
Comics are a mass favorite. So with this, we come to an end of this session. I'd like to thank our panelists, Mr. Pinaki Day and Mr. Ayushman Jamwal.
And Rimi.
And Rimi.
Rimi Chatterjee.
Rimi Chatterjee.
Mr. Rimi Chatterjee and?
Shonko Banerjee.
Mr. Shonko Banerjee. Okay, they were not on the list. Okay. These are the surprises. Okay. So I'd like to thank our panelists. And also I'd like to take this opportunity to thank our session partners, the Karam Chand Thapar Foundation, the Kumar Vyogi Memorial Trust, our hospitality partner, Ibis Kolkata Rajahat, the radio partner 91.9 Friends FM, our institutional partners, our food and beverage partner, Taifu and Flurus respectively, our wellness partner.